It's a privilege for me to welcome you on this beautiful afternoon to the Loma Linda University Church Sanctuary. I'm delighted and thrilled to have you here, and I think by the end of the evening you will be for having been here as well. My name is Randy Roberts. For those that I have not had the opportunity to meet, I'm privileged to lead the pastoral staff here at the University Church. Among our staff members is our Minister of Music, whose dream this has been, and that dream comes to fruition this evening. I want to extend a welcome not only to those of you who are joining us here in the sanctuary, but to all the musicians behind me, musicians representing the Loma Linda University Church and the Hollywood Presbyterian Church. Would you give them a warm welcome? I was here for different parts of the dress rehearsal last night, and I will tell you, you are in for something very, very special. I want to express my especial appreciation to Dr. Ariel Quintana, who is our Minister of Music, for all the work, all the energy, all the effort, the prayers, and especially the dream that has brought this to reality this evening. Thank you so much to Ariel. Greatly appreciated. Would you join me in a word of prayer? God, you are the giver of every good and every perfect gift. The gifts that we will enjoy and appreciate this afternoon are gifts that find their origin in your heart. We express our gratitude and our thankfulness for each one of these gifts, which will bless us today. Be with us during this time. Bless the musicians. Bless us all. In the name of Jesus, amen. Just two or three practical matters before we proceed with the program. First of all, this same program will be presented tomorrow afternoon at the Hollywood Presbyterian Church. The programs that you have in your hand, if you choose not to keep them, you may leave them on the pew because they will be recycled and used again tomorrow. At the end of the program, as you leave the sanctuary, there will be deacons in place to receive an offering. We would be most appreciative of that, because that will go to further the music ministry of the Loma Linda University Church. I want to ask you if you would do me a very special favor. Would you right now reach for something that looks a lot like this? Would you reach for that right now, and would you look and make certain that it is either in the silent or the off position? That would be greatly appreciated, not only now, but you will appreciate my having said that if somebody calls you during the program. So we want to make sure the program proceeds without such interruptions. Dr. René Ramos of La Sierra University has put much thought and many hours into the program you have in your hands. He is the one who has authored the notes that you have there, and he will come forward now to explain some about the program. Dr. Ramos.
I have been asked to say a few words regarding this work and the program notes. I'm a teacher at La Sierra, and I don't think I have had a class as large as this one. So I feel a little bit intimidated. So if you feel that you see that my mic is shaking, you know why. The work that you're going to listen to today is one of the great works of the 19th century, choral works of the 19th century. Much has been written about this work. There has been debates whether this is a sacred work or a secular work that happens to use religious words. There has been a lot of debate whether this is a dramatic work or a theatrical work. It is dramatic. It is not theatrical, it is dramatic. The best way to approach this work probably is by thinking of it as a an expression of the human drama in which all human beings come before God with a sense of, a keen sense of unworthiness. And every human being throws himself or herself on the mercy of God. If you read the text, and I will refer to a little bit more to that in a minute, if you read the text, you will notice that the entire text is mostly a prayer. All the texts are, all the different texts that are the different parts are prayers to God for different aspects, especially for deliverance from that terrible day, the day of judgment. There are parts in the work too that are descriptive, especially the famous Dies Irae, which is the second movement of the work, is descriptive. And if you are a student of the Bible, you will notice the imagery taken from different places from the Bible. I want to read some texts from the Bible that that you will see reflected in the text. I'm referring specifically to Malachi from the fourth chapter, the first verse, and I'm reading from the New King James Version. "For behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, and all the proud, yes, all who do wickedly will be stubble, and the day which is coming shall burn them up." Then in the same book, in chapter 3, in second verse, "But who can endure?" This is a rhetorical question. And you're going to notice that there are many rhetorical questions in the Dies Irae, the second movement of the work. "But who can endure the day of his coming? And who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like launderer's soap." In Revelation 6:14-17, says, "The sky receded as a scroll when it is rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. And the kings of the earth, the great men, the mighty men, said to the mountains and rocks, 'Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath has come, and who is able to stand?'" I want to refer to a few spots in the program notes to call your attention to the music that you will hear at that particular point. Notice that the program notes have the text in Latin, and then the translation, and then a short note following that. To talk about this work, you could, there are books that are devoted to this work. So program notes try to just highlight very small points. I want to highlight in the first movement, the title of which is Requiem, because that's the first word of the text. If you go to around the middle of the page, where it says Kyrie eleison, that's the point when the solo voices come in. When a composer writes a work of this kind, he tries to find a special spot in which the voices will come, and that highlights the voices. So it's not like that they sneak in, but they come on the stage, they kind of explode. And this is what happens here. This particular passage has been criticized by as being too operatic. Verdi was an opera composer, and he had a tremendous experience to writing for voices. And so here, if you notice, the opening portion of the movement is rather quiet. There is a passage that's loud, but it's rather quiet, and the chorus actually is kind of in the background. The melody, the musical interest is concentrated on the orchestra. When the solo voices come in, It's them now that have the interest. And Verdi uses that also as a way to emphasize the individual as opposed to the group of people. It's just a spine-chilling moment. I remember this morning Kimo Smith referred to his experience when he listened to this work for the first time. I didn't have a chance to listen it live, but I did listen many, many years to it in on a recording. And I remember the impact that those, I was a teenager then, the impact that those, the entrance of the solo voices caused on me. It's really overwhelming. The work is in many places very dramatic because the text is dramatic, but in other places the work is like a meditation. There are many passages in the text that are quiet, and especially when the speaker is talking in the first person then and pleading with God, then the music becomes more meditative, quiet, and you will notice that. In some cases, Verdi emphasized even specific words. In other cases, he took the general mood of a sentence or group of words and reflected that in the music. But sometimes he uses a specific word. I want you, for example, to notice, if you look at the second page, mors stupebit is for the solo bass, and the music mors, which means death, death is personified, and death is pictured as speechless, cannot talk. And the soloist sings the word mors, and there are big gaps of silence in which nothing happens. And so he is just referring to that. Preceding that, though, is the tuba mirum. The tuba mirum is a very dramatic entrance. Verdi requires two trumpets off stage, which supposedly should be invisible. Today, if you refrain from turning around, they will be invisible. So you can get a glimpse of the effect that he wanted. He wanted to have the sound of the trumpets coming from all places to represent the day when the last trumpet shall sound. it's another unforgettable passage. Another passage that I want to mention briefly. I need three hands here. If you turn the page, the Rex Tremendae Majestatis, you will see preceding that the solo singers sing without accompaniment. And it's a series of rhetorical questions again. And then the next verse says, Rex Tremendae, King of Great Majesty. That's sung by the men, by the basses at the beginning, by the basses especially, and they use a very a march-like rhythm. This is a rhythm that has been used since the 17th century, started in the 17th century with in French opera to represent the king, the glory of the king of Louis XIV in France. Very quickly, though, that kind of rhythm was translated into religious works to represent the glory of God. And that's what Verdi does here. He uses this very march-like rhythm to represent the majesty of God. And then, notice on the third line, Salvame fons pietatis. Those of you that that have no Spanish or even Italian and maybe French probably can relate to that, because in, at least in Spanish, Sálvame is just exactly the same sound. And it has a very special meaning, coming, Sálvame, save me. And that's again when the solo voices come in. And Verdi introduces a totally new, different melodic idea to represent a smoother, more gentle idea, if you will, to represent that pleading moment to God. I could continue, but I think I should stop. I was given 5 or 7 minutes, and I think I went beyond that. I said that sometimes I don't know what I want to say, but then once I start, I'm stoppable. So I better stop here. I do hope that you enjoy the work. There is much debate whether the work is, as I said before, whether it is sacred or not. It is an expression of the human drama, and that's the way that Verdi approached it. It was not necessarily a religious work for him, and so just sit back, realize. Follow the program. You can read the text and you can read the notes. I have 2 things to say before I quit. First of all, I would like to ask you not to take flash photographs. It's very disturbing to the singers when they see the flashes, and because they need to keep their concentration. The other thing that I need to say is please refrain from applauding until the very end. Again, that breaks the spell of the moment if there is applause. So at the very end, you will have a chance to do it. And I think that's all for now.
Thank you. superbit et natura, cum resurget creatura, iuricam tine sponsor.
Thank you.
Oh,
Thank you.
Oh,
Tremenda.